Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17 through 19. I want to begin with this morning. And I want to tag a little bit on to what I said last week, and I'll get to this. I'll pick this back up in just a few moments. As I was sitting beside my father, who was transitioning from this earth life into his eternal life with Jesus, the Lord spoke some things to me, I believe, for comfort in a time of sorrow, but also revelation in a time of revival. And those two things were what I brought to you last week and what I'm bringing to you this week, and that is the life of God and the love of God. And if we can take the life of God to a world who is full of death, we will be able to, come on y'all, there will be a harvest like we have never seen before. Amen? But after studying what I have studied this week, I wholeheartedly believe that if we can take and show, if we can receive and take and show the love of God to a world that is so full of hate, a world that is so full of bitterness, a world that is so broken, we will see, yes, a harvest come into this place and come into the kingdom like we have never thought, dreamed, or imagined. Does anybody believe that? And as the Lord began to minister to me, and I'll pick that back up in a moment, as I was sitting with my dad in his last days on this earth before he entered into eternity, the Lord did something on the inside of me. And how many know those times are important times? Amen. And this scripture that I have preached from before came alive on the inside of me, and others that I will read to you today. And I want you, by the power of the Holy Spirit, as you read along, as I read out loud, to let this bring life and explode on the inside of you what the Apostle Paul was trying to say. As he said, I am praying that Christ, through your faith, will actually dwell and settle down and abide and make his permanent home in your hearts. May you be rooted deep in love and founded securely on love, that you may have the power and be strong to apprehend and grasp with all of God's devoted people the experience of that love, what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth of that love, that you may come to know, everybody say come to know, that you may come to know practically through experience for yourselves the love of Christ, which surpasses mere knowledge. Now that just confused me, because we got to come to know something that surpasses knowledge. Hello? We got to be able to understand and comprehend something that surpasses knowledge. And then the Amplified Bible says something that surpasses mere knowledge without experience. So what the apostle is saying here is that this is a love that must be comprehended, and it's comprehended through experience, that love. I've got to experience the breadth and the length and the height and the depth of that love. And then he says this, that you may be filled, everybody shout, filled, that you may be filled throughout all your being, look at this, unto all the fullness of God, that you may have the richest measure of the divine presence and become a body wholly filled and flooded with God himself. How many know we want to be full of God? Hello. How many know that we sing a lot around here and we talk a lot around here about the fullness of God? We say, fill me up. We sing it to an extent today. Release the fullness. And how many understand that we're going to continue to say, fill me up, God, and release the fullness? Because every time that we say, fill me up, and every time we say, release the fullness, God releases a little bit more of himself. But I got to show you something today, because in this verse in Ephesians, as the Lord began to open this up to me, I see that the fullness of God and being flooded and filled with God himself is connected to understanding the love of Christ and to experiencing the love of Christ. Ah. Being filled and flooded with God and having the fullness of God. You see, we wanted it to be speaking in tongues, or we wanted it to be falling out in the Spirit, or we wanted it to be some of these others, more visible manifestations of the Spirit, and we're all about that if it's pure and in the Spirit. But what the apostle is telling us is that if we want the fullness of God, if we want to be filled and flooded with all of God, then it begins with understanding and experiencing the love of Jesus Christ. Hello. How many understand that there are many believers in Christ who have traded their experience of the love of Christ for a mere explanation about the love of Christ? We've traded this experience of the love of Christ, and now as we've lived for the Lord, many of us in the room today, it's just a mere explanation about the love of Christ. But what this verse showed me is that the fullness of God, everybody say the fullness, look at your neighbor, say the fullness of God begins and it ends with apprehending and understanding and experiencing the love of God. The fullness of God does not begin with worship. It does not begin with speaking in tongues. It does not even begin with evangelism. Can I get a church to help me preach about the love of God? It doesn't begin with those things. The Apostle Paul says the fullness of God begins and it ends with apprehending and comprehending and understanding and most of all experiencing the love of God, which is brought to us in Christ Jesus. And I'm coming to realize that all of these things, the worship and the tongues and the works and the evangelism, that all of these are a means to an end. And folks, I came to tell us today, this may not be very exciting to you, but the end of everything is the love of God. He is the beginning and He is the end. He is the Alpha and the Omega. The reason why He began this thing was because God so loved the world. And the reason why He wants to get you into eternity with Him is because He loves you so much and He wants to spend forever with you. The fullness of God begins and ends with the love of God. The fullness of God, being filled with the fullness of God, begins and ends with understanding and comprehending the breadth and the length and the height and the depth of the love of God. The deeper that I go in God, the deeper that I go in His love. And I want to give you a vision today for just how far you can go in this reality of experiencing the burning heart of God's love, to experience His love and to express His love. But as I said last week, there's a lot of phrases and there's a lot of cliches that we use in church today that we really don't have a clue what they mean. Hello, amen. Or at least we have a very shallow understanding of them. And just like I said, we didn't really understand the river of God and the life of God. The love of God is another one of them that we talk about and we sing about it. That's why I exhorted some of you as we were singing, He Loves Us. This is a song that we've sang hundreds of times around here. But God, today, can we really begin to understand the breadth and the length and the depth and the height of how much You love us? Because until I begin to understand to that degree, I am not filled with the fullness of God. I am of the opinion, hear what I'm about to say, that most of our spiritual inconsistencies, and let me just define and kind of make it plain for you, what is a spiritual inconsistencies? Well, many people today in Christian world get easily bored with spiritual things. They get easily bored with prayer. Prayer is a duty. Worship is a duty. Coming to church is a duty, and it's dry and it's routine. I believe that much of our spiritual inconsistencies are due to the fact that we do not understand through experience the love of Christ. I am preaching a thing up here this morning. We are in and out and we are up and down and we're running to everything else to find love. The secular world has written song after song after song after song, and one of them, and I'm looking for love in all of the wrong places. I come to tell somebody today, I think that's a song. Isn't that a song? Many of y'all been looking for love in all the wrong places, and I'm not going with the theme that they were going with. I'm just saying we have a world and we have a church full of people that are looking for a love, but it is a superficial love because they have not gone deep enough in God to understand the breadth and the length and the depth and the height of God's love for us. I am convinced that this next wave is literally going to come as a tsunami over this place, not because we speak in tongues, not because we fall out, but because
him. Praise him now. Come on. Praise him. Make some noise in this place. If you know that the fullness comes by comprehending the love of God.
If God has loved me as much as I've been taught to believe, then it shows the reason that he also desires that I would come to personally experience that love. Amen. A visitation of his love, church, changes absolutely everything. There is nothing that the love of God cannot heal. There is nothing that the love of God cannot change. No matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, no matter how bad you've messed up, there is nothing that will change the love of God. You may not love him back, but he will keep on loving you. You may not understand, but he will keep on loving you. He will never stop. Tell your neighbor he'll never stop. He'll never stop. He'll never stop loving you, but you and I must choose to love him. Somebody needs to understand in the room today that God can't love you any more than he loves you right now. I said he can't love you any more than he loves you right now. God is not somehow going to muster up more love for you. God has done, Jesus has done absolutely everything needed to be done to accomplish what needs to be accomplished to fulfill the love that he has for you. You can't work hard enough. You got to hear me now. Now, I know that this message is out of balance in the body of Christ today. I know that there are preachers out there that are preaching the love of God and they are prostituting it. In other words, they are preaching it as an excuse to just live any way that you want. If you come to this church 5 minutes, you know that we don't preach like that. But I got to get a word out because I am ushering in the next wave of the revival. As I sat there beside my dad as he was taking his last final breaths on this earth, the Lord opened up to me, Kim, I am in heaven. And there is such a love in heaven that I want to get to this earth. But my people who are called by my name must get up out of their pretense. They must get up out of their little church circles and they must get on their face before me and begin to understand the depth of my love so that I can put my love in them to flow to a dying world. So somebody needs to understand today, God's not going to love you anymore. And you can't work enough for him, do enough things. So the Holy Spirit told me this morning, said, tell somebody, stop waiting to be good enough for God's love. If we could get good enough for God's love, then Jesus would not have had to come and die for us. You got to come to his love right now, how you are. Now is the time. God did not make man for time, but he made time for man. God did not make man for time, but he made time for man. And so now is the time that we are to choose his life, as I preached last week, and we are to choose the love of God. He has given us this span called time to choose his love now, to understand and to experience his love now, and to express his love. Because of sin, God created this span called time. Come on, somebody. He's given us this span called time to choose his life and his light and his love. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. 1 John 4:16. And we have known and believed the love of God, the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God. My goodness, I know where I'm going and oh my word. Somebody say, I'm ready. I'm ready. The love that God has for us, God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Let me tell you something. The greatest truth of the Word of God is that God is love. That right there proves we don't know. I'm right with you. I'm right with you. Seriously, I'm right with you. We have heard this so much, but yet we have not applied ourselves to this, that God is love. He is wholehearted love. It's not a passive love. It's not a tame love. It's not a docile type of love. It is the very essence of who he is. It is the very essence of how he thinks. It is the very essence of how he feels. He has wisdom. He has power, yes, but he uses his power and he uses his wisdom for one reason, and that is to express his love. Hallelujah. His love is an erupting desire within his heart as he engages in relationship with you and I. This kind of love that God has is a a first to God. Everybody shout first. And this is why that he calls you and I to make it first in our lives. Matthew chapter 22, verses 37 and 38. And Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the first. Somebody shout first. This is the first and great commandment. Can I just tell you, it's not a suggestion. It is a commandment to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your mind, and your soul. This is the first commandment. You see, love was first to God, and he wants it to be first to us. Can I just tell you that the atmosphere of love will defeat religion every single time? And you've got to understand where I'm coming from. Jesus was speaking this scripture here because he was answering religion. He was answering the Pharisees. He was answering the smart alecks. Come on. He was answering the smarty pants. Hello, y'all. He was. Read your Bible. He was answering them, and he says, I'll tell you what the first and the greatest commandment is. All of you guys who think you know so much, all of you who have gone so deep that you're stuck in a rut and you're boring and hello. He said, let me tell you what the first and the greatest commandment. It is to love God with all of your heart, your mind, and your soul. It is the first and the greatest commandment. And yes, I know, and then love your neighbor as yourself. But let me emphasize this. Jesus identified this as the first commandment because he understood that this is the highest priority to God forever. It was like Jesus was saying, this is the absolute first priority to God in this age and in the age to come. You'll never have a greater calling. You'll never have a greater mantle. You'll never have a greater revelation than to enter into this reality. And the reality is this, that you love the Lord your God with everything that is within you. It is the greatest reality of the kingdom of God. Do I have a church in here that wants to experience the fullness of God? Well, it begins with understanding the love of God. The last Sunday night that we that I was here, that we had the Sunday night revival, I preached back in July, and I said this, that the next wave of revival in this house will require us falling in love with Jesus all over again. Come on, y'all. And I referenced the church at Ephesus who had left their first. Everybody say first. They had left their first love. I need to tell some of us in the room today that God must be first. It's impossible to make him second or third. If God is not first in our life, he can't be second or third, because if he's not first, then he is not Lord at all. Come on. If he's not the first, and God has a principle in his word, and it's called first fruits, and he commands that we bring him the first fruits. And this not only applies to our tithe, but it applies to our time, and most of all, it applies to our heart and the love that is, oh, I'm preaching up here. Come on. I thought about this, and I began to read that verse in Ephesians differently, that talked about Ephesus differently, that talked about the church that had lost their first love. He told them to return to their first love. In other words, he's speaking to us, stop bringing him the leftover love and begin to bring him the first fruit love that he is asking for. Because how many know that love is the first fruit of the Spirit that is listed in Galatians 5? The Bible says he first loved us. And here we are in Matthew. Jesus is saying that love is the absolute priority, the first priority to God now in this earth and throughout eternity. Amen? But we're not going to understand that unless we know and understand how much God loves us. John 15:9. Let me just say this first. God did not create us because he needed us. He created us because love compelled him to create. He had to share his love. And love, by the very definition, demands that it be shared. If love is not shared, it is not love. So God made a plan to create a race of human beings, of beings on whom his love could be poured out and on whom his love could be focused. And as a response to that love, we would then give back to him out of the overflow of that love, the love out of our heart back to him. And then out of the overflow
overflow of that love. Come on, do you see the cycle or the circle here? We would begin to love one another and we would begin to love the world. I am convinced that most of the problem and the issue in the body of Christ stems from the fact that we don't understand the breadth and the depth and the height of God's love. He needs us to plunge deep into his love today. There is a river of love and we need to be swimming in the river of love. And let me just stop and say this. Help me, Holy Spirit, is that we have so perverted love. If we can't make love sexual, we make it sensual. If we can't make it sensual, we make it silly. If we can't make it silly, then we make it stupid. Come on, somebody. This is what the devil has done to pervert the love of God. But I come to tell you today that there is a pure river of love that flows from God himself. And in this place, we need to be swimming understand love in its eternal context, that we don't see it as a duty. In other words, I do something to get something. It's the truth. Isn't that how the world loves? I do something for you and I get something in return. No, but it's a participation. It's a participation in something that is so glorious and so awesome. Now, don't miss what I'm about to say. And write this down if you're taking notes. We participate in something so glorious and so awesome, it literally frames eternity and heaven. I'm talking about the love of God. It frames eternity and it frames heaven. Our greatest destiny is to participate in the love that God has for us, not just to underline those verses in our Bible, not just to sing a song about it and tell a friend about it or put it on a postcard and then move on and leave it. Our greatest destiny is to participate in the reality forever that God loves me and he wants me to love him. This is what the kingdom of God is all about, and somebody needs to know today that everything in heaven is framed in the love of God. And when the church finally arises and understands that the fullness of God comes from the love of God, then God is going to be able to frame his church like he's always wanted to frame his church, and that is with the atmosphere of heaven. Yes. John 15:9, as the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. Jesus is saying with the same intensity that the Father loves me, I love you. Ha. Huh? And he said, now you need to abide in that. You don't move on from that. Don't try to find something deeper. You got to live there. You got to dwell there. Don't graduate from that focus. You don't talk about it for a few weeks and then move on. You got to pray. You got to move into the love of God. You got to let it sink deep. Jesus was emphasizing to us, this is absolutely the atmosphere of eternity. The love of God is the atmosphere of eternity. And he was telling us by that scripture, abide there. He was saying, you got to dwell there. The Apostle Paul said, you got to be rooted in that. You got to be grounded in that. You got to experience it. You got to understand it. It's got to be the motivation of everything else that we do. Man, we got so much stuff that is jacked up in the church world today. Hear what I'm about to say. And I'm not dissing anybody necessarily. I'm including myself in this. But we have got selfish ambition and selfish motivation. And we've got a pseudo love that is driving things in the body of Christ. But God is saying in this next wave, I am coming with a baptism and a visitation of the atmosphere of heaven. And the atmosphere of heaven is my unconditional, undenying, undeniable love. And it's going to penetrate every single heart. I can see into my spirit's eye now as things are getting more evil and more evil and more evil in the world. The love of God, like a river, is going to begin to rise in his church and rise in his people. And as the evil begins to go higher and higher in the world, the love of God gets higher and higher in and through his church. This is how we're going to see an end time harvest. I'm not talking about a wimpy love that doesn't speak truth. Y'all help me now. I don't have time to go there. We preach that all the time. I'm not talking about a love that withholds truth and that just lets people do what they want to do. I'm talking about a love that will speak the truth in love, getting them back on the right track. Come on. Overcoming evil with good. Overcoming wrong with the love of God. Somebody shout love. foundation of everything that we do, our primary focus and our primary goal as in life and as a church is to be focused on receiving and expressing God's love. We are to make this the primary preoccupation of our life. Church, come on. Before and during and after revival, we must be motivated by the atmosphere of heaven that God loves us and we love God with all of our heart. I'm reminded what Sean Smith wrote in his book. He said, when the lost see a supernatural love-struck look on our faces, then they are drawn to Jesus as if by divine magnetism. And Sean goes on to tell a story. Y'all stay with me now. He goes on to tell a story after he made that statement about a young teenage girl whose testimony sparked the Wells Revival of 1904. Just her simple testimony. She was giving a testimony in a youth meeting, a teenage girl. And all she said, y'all, was she stood up and said, I love Jesus with all of my heart. That's all she said. And as a result of that, the power of God and the love of God and the anointing of God and the Shekinah of God came down into that room, and it sparked a revival fire that spread across Wales and spread across that continent and spread across the nations of the world. The history tells us that the Welsh revival was the largest Christian revival in Wales in the 20th century. It had the most profound impact on society and culture in that day, not only in that nation, but the nations of the world. And the Wales revival was the primary catalyst for the Azusa Street revival that took place in Los Angeles, California, which we stand here day after day and week after week rejigging the well of revival in Azusa Street. And I came to tell us today, the answer is in the love of God. Am I making sense? The answer's in the love of God. All she said was, I love Jesus with all my heart. She didn't speak in tongues. And if you need that today, I can pray you through to that. But you got to understand, sometimes we so trivialized the love of God at the expense, or we so exalted all of this other stuff at the expense of the love of God. And the Holy Spirit spoke to me as I was sitting by my father, who was taking his last breath on this earth, and I was reading something that I'm getting ready to read to you here in just a moment. And he said, if you want the fullness, Kim, if you want the next wave, if you want the Shekinah, if you want the tsunami, if you want the next wave, if you want to usher in the harvest of souls, then understand the height and the length and the breadth and the depth of my love, because until you understand that, you will not be able to reach a lost and dying world. Not to mention we stay all jacked up ourselves, amen? Look at your neighbor and say, God loves you, God loves you. Come on, screaming at him. She said, I love Jesus with all my heart. That's all she said. As I was preparing for this message, I was like, God, please, can I just get up here and say, I love Jesus with all my heart? And then, boom. But apparently I can't, because I haven't arrived where that little girl was. But I can tell you that I want to. I want to. And God sent me up here today to tell you that there is a river. And I want to create a hunger, that there is a reality of the love of God that you can walk in and understand, that you can experience and you can express. And Fresh Start at this revival is going to continue to go to levels and levels and levels. And we want to see, and we still crave the fullness of God. The Holy Spirit said, you got to start with the love of God. We want to set a territory on fire with the power of the Holy Spirit. It's the love of God. Yes? Now, for those of you who weren't here last week, you're going to miss some stuff, because I'm just going to take off reading for the sake of time. But I set this up last week about the articles
that I came across when I was sitting with my father as he was in his final days here on this earth before he walked into eternity. And what I'm getting ready to read to you is a few more excerpts of that. And I do this, you guys. It was a comfort for me in a time of sorrow, but it was also revelation for me in a time of revival. And I keep saying that because I want you to understand, because I don't normally just read stuff. But I use these again today because they help our human limitation. They help us to grasp the reality of the elements of life and love. Because some of you, and I shouldn't say it like that, but because I know how I am. It's like sometimes we just, oh, I know that. Let's move on. I know that. But we haven't stopped to grasp and experience the depth of what God is trying to speak. And so I speak to you from three different instances here, non-related people, two of which physically died and went to heaven and came back, and one who saw a vision. And once again, I explained all that last week, and I got time today, so I'm just going to read it to you. This was the man that was dead for an hour and 45 minutes. And let me repeat something I said a moment ago. Heaven is framed with love. When you frame something, it's around every part of it. Amen? Heaven is framed in love. As he was standing in heaven, he'd been dead for an hour and 45 minutes. He said, what really got me was the love that his feet showed me. Jesus' feet. He loved me so much that I did not have to look at his face to experience the love that he has for me. I did not have to see another part of Jesus to know how much he loved me. His feet expressed his love for me. If all I saw was his feet, I knew he loved me. It was not only that he loved me, but it only was like I was the only one that he loved in all of creation. I knew that he loved others, but it seemed as if I was the only one. I looked at his hands and I experienced the same love. Yeah, you can see the nail piercings that took place in his hands, but again, it was the love that was coming out of them to me that expressed his love for me. If I was to only have seen his hands and not another part of him, I would have known how much he loves me. The Bible says in 1 John 4:7 that God is love. As I looked at the other parts of his body, I experienced over and over and over and over again the love of Jesus for me, coming from all of those different body parts. His body could only express his love for me. I saw what his body went through just for me. I saw what it cost for me to be there with him and have a relationship with the Heavenly Father. I was on my hands and my knees and I looked right into his face. Oh, how do I tell you what his face looks like? His face was as if it were liquid crystal glass made up of pure love, light, and life. Everything about him is love. Yes, love for you, and it seemed as if the love was only for me, yet you know in yourself he loves all, but the love is for you. The love for you is so personal. It seems as if it is only for you. You know he has cared for you forever and will care for you forever. You do not want to leave this kind of outpouring of love for you. When you look at any part of his body, you knew he loves you so much. His love is alive. There you go. It is more than just a sense. His brightness is before you. It's around you. It's a part of you. It's in you. And you are becoming his love. Our God is pure life and light and love. And you become what he is, life and light and love. Jesus spoke to me with his voice, and his voice is love. And I came to understand who the real gatekeeper of heaven is. It is only Jesus. I understood this is the last time he spoke to him. He said, you've got to go back. Your time is not finished. And he said, I understood that he is the gatekeeper when he told me to go back, because I saw in his eyes the love for humanity. I saw the love for every man, for every woman, for every boy, and for every girl. I looked into Jesus's eyes, and his eyes were flames of fire with changing colors of red and orange and blue and green and yellow and many other colors. John said it in Revelation, his eyes are a flame of a fire, and I experienced in his eyes that they are deep and they are full of life. You could get lost in his eyes and never want to come out. In his eyes, I saw the love for every human and creation of God. God. It just seemed like it was for me. But then I thought about somebody else, and then I saw the love of Jesus for them. But then it was like it was just for me, but I thought of someone else, and I saw the love of Jesus for them. The same thing happened over and over and over. I did this a number of times, and I saw in his eyes that he wanted everyone in heaven who are still alive on this earth. He did not want to lose one person or have them go to hell. Jesus wants all people to be saved. I wish we could understand that. He loves everyone. The Father, Jesus, the Holy Spirit loves everyone so much. During this time, when I looked in his eyes and I saw this love, I knew I had become that love also. And he says, if you have Jesus, you have all the love that is in Jesus. It is in you. And during that time of looking to his eyes, he said, I had a communication with him. Now, I pause to say this, because what I'm getting ready to tell you, I have read from several different accounts of people who have either died and gone to heaven or have seen a vision of heaven. And this is what they said. That he said, I was looking into his eyes, and we had communication in our thoughts. There were no words spoken. I want to pause and say this, and everybody listen to what I'm about to say. I read this several times, and I thought it was very interesting, but it completely makes sense with the knowledge of the Word of God. Because in heaven, you are spirit. And there are several that have said you communicate, and it's like you're talking as we know on this earth, but you're not really verbalizing because you don't need that in heaven because it's your spirit. And so when Jesus speaks to you, it is spirit to spirit. I want to pause and say this at this point here, because it's very, very important. Your spirit, when you get to heaven, is not going to have any pretense. Okay, I guess I need to make it a little plainer. You know how you cover up things now, and you know how to lie well? You're not going to be able to do that in heaven. Whether you spend eternity in heaven with Jesus or in hell, come on, you guys, you're not going to be able to cover up things. We're not going to be able to gloss over that. You know how we can kind of sweep things under the rug? You know how we can kind of make people think what we want them to think? We are going to stand before our Creator. Come on, spirit to spirit, spirit to spirit. It's not going to be your head talking. It's not going to be your mouth talking. It's not going to be your emotions talking. It's not going to be your mind talking. It's going to be your spirit talking. And your spirit is going to reveal everything. I came to preach right now. Come on, because I got to tell somebody, this is why it's important what you allow into your spirit, what you allow into your eyes, and what you allow into your ears, and what you allow into your brain. Because it's not only going into your eyes, it's not only going to your ears, it's not only going into your emotions, but it is sinking down into your spirit. And your spirit is soaking that up, and your spirit never forgets that. You got to understand there is a devil, and the devil does not play fair, and he will get you to believe that playing Pokemon is okay and playing this game is okay. Oh my God, I didn't know I was going to preach on Pokemon today. Parents, you got to watch what your children do. Hang on, I'm going to get back to heaven in just a moment. I'm going to get back to the love of God in just a moment. But my job and my assignment on this earth is to help you understand, as I said last week, that you don't just cross from this earth and go over and everything is fine and different. You are building for eternity right now. And what you are putting into your life is going to live forever. You are a spirit being first, and then you are body and flesh. Come on, and mind. The little bit that I know about Pokemon isn't good, y'all. I'm just going to say it. Because I'm the one that usually has to say it, so I'm going to say it. I know enough. I know very little. I know just enough about Pokemon, but I know a lot about the demonic realm. And if they got things that they're releasing out into a territory, come on, we preached on taking the territory in this church for months now. Why in God's name were we going to want to go out and chase something that is a demon-like monster creature that they are releasing into different areas of the demon monster-like creatures that they are releasing into the territories in your neighborhood, in my neighborhood. I woke up one night praying in the Holy Ghost saying, in Jesus' name, whatever in the world Pokemon has put out in my neighborhood, I plead the blood of Jesus Christ. You call
to spirit. Spirit to spirit. Spirit to spirit. Spirit to spirit. And the devil understands the concept of the spirit realm, and he better than you do. And he understands the concept of the spiritual and spirituality. And so if he can get us in a pseudo, come on, pursuit of some kind of thing, whether it's Pokemon or something else, then he's going to get us consumed and wrapped up in our time of pursuing everything that is not the Spirit of God.
Wow, that wasn't in my notes, I promise. So anyway, I had to hurry. Really got to hurry. So anyway, your spirit cannot deceive and your spirit will not lie. So many of the accounts that I read, it was spirit to spirit. So it would be like, it's different than this because we can't put our English words on it or our natural words on it. But it's like you're thinking it and everyone just knows. Now, there may be some language there. I believe there is a heavenly language, but this is several accounts that have said they've experienced the same thing. And he said, during this time of looking into the eyes of Jesus, he said, we had this communication. No words were spoken. And I said to him, Lord, even the child molesters, you love them. And he has worked with abused children and teenagers for 33 years, this man that gave this account. And he's seen some horrible, 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 horrible things. And Jesus said back to me, he said, when you place a person in jail, they get out. They either get out when their time is up or they get out when they die, but they get out. But when we put a person in hell, they are there for eternity. And he looked at my eyes with the fiery red flame and he said, who are you to nullify what I have done? This came across very stern and I saw him with his outstretched arms like he was on the cross and he had paid the price for everyone who sinned or whoever will sin, implying that we do not have a right to condemn anyone since he does not. I knew that I knew he wanted all people there with him. He truly wants us there with him, all people. Another man had a vision, and these next two are very short, and this last one, and then I'm closing with this, sort of closing with this. He said, in this vision, he said, I was completely and totally saturated with love. Every molecule of my being, or whatever you want to call it, was permeated. His love was so powerful, it literally touches every part of you. And I realized in that moment, here on earth in this life, we are poorly equipped for the expression of this great love. We get glimpses of love through the nice things we do, the things we say, and the tears we shed. We can only attempt to express this through our acts and our words. But in heaven, love is not expressed. It simply and magnificently just is, because God is love. His love is so pure, it's tangible. You can touch it and you can see it. And finally, another man who had died and gone to heaven and came back to life back in the 70s, 1970s. He gives this account. Listen very closely. He said, as we walked down, he's talking about himself. This is after he had died. And an angel or someone, a being that was with him. We walked down the mouth of that tunnel, he said. The transition from the earth life to the eternal life was just a moment. He said, but I stepped out and something fell on me. It was like a joy that I've never known before. It was just fell all over me, and I was wrapped up like a cocoon in it. And I said, what is this joy? And he said, it's the love of God that has fallen on you. And I was thinking, it's so bright. And he said, yeah, that's the glory of God. So the love and the glory are like a cocoon, and I was wrapped up in it. Did you hear what I just said? The love and the glory are like a cocoon. And you're wrapped up in it. He said, if I could take all of the good feelings I've ever had in life and multiply it 1,000 times over, it will never compare to that. I felt totally loved. I felt the glory of God just surround me like a blanket of love, a cocoon of love. So I asked the man standing beside me, what is this? He said again, it's the love of God. And then I stepped out into the light and I saw a line. Now, for the sake of time today, and I'm totally out of it now, but he saw two lines. You hear me now. He died and went to heaven. One line was going into heaven. The other another line into eternal hell. And he said, I saw a line leading to the man, capital M, with the blue eyes. Now listen to me. I just explained to you another man's accounts of the eyes of Jesus Christ. And here's someone totally unrelated that describes the eyes of Jesus the exact same way. And he said, I saw people in a line that was in front of me. And as the line got closer and closer, the light to the light, then I began to hear him speak one thing to each of them. And I saw a woman, and she had over 100 angels with her. And I asked this man beside me, why so many angels? And he said, she was a great evangelist and a great mother in her time, but now it's her time to go home. And I watched as she came close to him, Jesus, and he asked her one question, and it was like this: daughter, did you learn to love? And she threw her hands up and she said, oh yes, Lord, I learned to love. And then he kissed her on the lips, and the double doors of his heart opened up, and he put his arms around her, and she went right into his heart and all of the angels with her. And there was in front of me another woman that had died at the age of 93, and her fingers were huge knots. Arthritis had attacked her body and her hands for, I would say, 50 years. And she lived in great pain with this arthritis. And he asked her the same question, did you learn to love? And she said, only you, Lord. I lost my husband when I was young, and I got bitter. I stayed in church, but I never really did anything but bite people because of my bitterness. But she wasn't in love. And he told her, you are saved by grace, but in heaven, oh my God, you have no rewards. You'll be the least in the kingdom of heaven because you did not learn to love. But she went in, and then I was next. Now understand what I'm saying to you today. As I said last week, I'm not preaching this as gospel, as if it was the word of God, but there are so many things that are similar with the principles, come on, of the word of God. Hang on, I'm almost through. With the word of God, that I must release to us a question today. I don't know if this is a question that God is going to ask each of us before we enter into eternity, but with the principles of the Word of God, I can say that it's highly likely that one of the things that He will require of us, and I'm going to give you a bunch of scripture that I'm going to read real fast here in a moment to prove what I'm saying. He is going to require of us, and maybe even ask us, did you learn to love? And I'm asking us in this room today, how much effort are we putting in to the first and the greatest commandment? Because the decision to love must be made before we leave this earthly body. It must be made before we leave this time, this span called time. The first step is that we come to Christ, and then I must daily choose to give God and to give people the first fruits of my love. Did you learn to love, Kim? Did you learn to love? Put your name in there. Did you learn to love? I'm going to give you some scripture right now, and I'm going to go very, very fast, but I'm believing and I pray that the Holy Spirit will use the Word of God to spark faith and revelation in our heart, because I'm telling you, if I were to read every scripture that is either on the love of God or the love for God, I would have to start in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, and I would have to read every single verse to Revelation chapter 22, verse 21. Why? Because every single verse of the Word of God is laced with the love of God. Yes, even in the judgment of God, when God releases judgment, the only reason is that He's trying to remove everything that hinders the love of God. Are you hearing what I'm saying today? Did you learn to love? Did you learn to love? 1 Corinthians 13, though I speak with the tongue of men and angels, but have not love, I have become as a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, and I understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. I bestow all of my goods to feed the poor and give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. John 13, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this love, all will know that you are my disciples if you have love one for another. Fasten your seatbelts. It gets better. 1 John chapter 4, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him. In
is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and he sent his son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, then God abides in us and his love has been perfected in us. By this love, we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given of us of his spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God is in him. Listen to the word. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but love casts out all fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We loved him because he first loved us. And finally, if someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, then he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother. Did you learn to love? Love and unforgiveness can't exist in the same heart. Bitter and sweet waters cannot live in the same heart. Loving means that I have to forgive. If we have not learned to be a vessel of love to others, then we have accomplished nothing, the Bible says. And I need to let somebody know today, hallelujah, Holy Spirit, whatever has come against you in your life, that you've been holding on to bitterness, as that old woman was standing before the Lord, you got to let it go, because you're a slave to that thing. And you've heard 1,000 messages on releasing forgiveness, but you've not done it yet. And God sent me to tell you today, I don't want you to stand before him shriveled up, even if it's not with arthritis, but with other something else. And you say, Lord, I loved you, but I couldn't love anybody else. Forgiveness will release a spiritual authority into your life that makes you begin to rule in the midst of your enemies. And if that is true, then the opposite is true. Unforgiveness will keep you a slave to that person, will keep you a slave to that circumstance, will keep you a slave to that issue. You will always be mentally and emotionally serving them. Yes? Amen? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians, and I'm not going to read all of it, but I want to read the last part there, that love suffers long and is kind. It does not envy. It does not parade, et cetera, puffed up. It does not keep, bears all things, hopes all things. It does not seek his own. It does not keep a list, the Amplified Bible says, of injustices that have been done to me. The Bible says that love never fails, and that the greatest of these, faith and hope and love, the greatest of these is love. Somebody needs to understand today, because you're sitting out there and you're saying, I can't love like that. Yes, you can. Because on the inside of you is Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says in Romans 5:5 that the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. It is absolutely possible for you to walk in the kind of love and responding in the kind of love that Jesus responded with. I'm closing with this. Watch. When you respond with love to that circumstance or that situation, what you are doing is you are literally shifting the atmosphere over that circumstance. Can I tell you that the devil has no answers to love? The devil has no defenses to love. If you choose to love when hate and when offense is all around you, when you choose to release the fragrance of love, you absolutely disarm everything the enemy has to offer. You disarm. You disarm that person. You disarm their argument. You can't argue with love. You can't argue with love. You can't argue with love. Is anybody getting what I'm saying? The devil can't stand up against love. When Jesus on the cross, the devil thought he had accomplished all that he could accomplish. He thought he had won. He had his chest poked out and said, now I've got humankind gave him one last blow before he took his last earthly breath. He cried out, "Father, forgive them, because they don't know what they are doing." And the moment that Jesus cried out, "Father, forgive them," he released the atmosphere of heaven into this earth and into your heart. Disarm every one of their defenses, and you disarm the spirits of darkness that are trying to work and around that relationship. And in your life, the devil cannot prevail in that situation.